You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with the Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit to Russia, where the two countries committed to further enhance their bilateral ties. They signed multiple energy deals and set the annual trade target of $30 billion by 2025. India also offered $1 billion line of credit for the development of Russian Far East. A report.
Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi was accorded a guard of honour as he received a grand welcome on his touchdown to Russian city of Vladivostok for the two-day Eastern Economic Forum. The journey started on strong personal note between Prime Minister Modi and Russian President Vladimir Putin, who went on a shipyard together and informally discussed the entire gamut of bilateral ties that is poised to see an expansion in coming times. The 20th annual bilateral summit held on the sidelines covered a number of regional and international issues of mutual interest. Russia reiterated its commitment of continuously supporting India in building its strong arsenal.
Россия не только поставляет в Индию вооружение. Вместе с индийскими партнерами налажено производство новейшей продукции военного назначения. Реализуются совместные проекты по выпуску в Индии стрелкового оружия серии Калашников, вертолетов К-226Т, ракетных ударных систем, строительство современной АЭС Кудамкула. В рабочем режиме функционируют первые два ее блока. По графику ведется сооружение третьего и четвертого блоков. По имеющимся договоренностям в течение 20 лет будут возведены не менее 12 энергоблоков по российскому дизайну.
Both countries also exchanged 25 agreements in the field of defense, trade, industrial cooperation, investments, connectivity corridors and energy. India and Russia also agreed to the proposal of Russia building 20 more nuclear power plants in India. Modi apprised that the two countries have also agreed on cooperation in hydrocarbon and liquefied natural gas exploration in the Arctic Circle. Indian astronauts will train in Russian space exploration facilities for its ambitious human space flight mission in 2021.
Is sector mein sahyog ke liye 5 saal ka roadmap aur far east tatha arctic mein hydrocarbon aur lng ki khoj mein sahyog par sahmati hui hai. Space mein hamara lamba sahyog nayi unchaiyon ko chhu raha hai. Gaganyaan, yani Bharatiya human space flight ke liye, Bharat ke astronauts Rus mein training karenge.
Apart from regular energy exploration agreements, India and Russia have also agreed on cooperation in coal, oil and other sources of energy. Last year, Russia had given 5 million tons of coal to India and both the countries decided to take this further.
Moving on, Zalmay Khalilzad, the U.S. envoy for peace in Afghanistan, has confirmed that the final draft between the Taliban and the United States has been finalized and requires only presidential assent to come into force. He has also spilled the beans on troop withdrawal from Afghanistan, which continues to remain in a state of war. The United States says they will pull out a significant portion of their military presence in Afghanistan if the insurgents abide by the terms and conditions put forth by them. A report.
The United States says that it will withdraw as many as 5,000 troops from Afghanistan in just 4.5 months of the enactment of the peace accord over which the US and the Taliban have been working for months. The decision comes at the heels of two sides hammering out a deal where one demands another's ouster from their territory and other seeks to eliminate terrorism. The US, although has not been fighting the Taliban directly, but has provided other forms of assistance to Kabul since its official disengagement as combative force in 2014.
در پرنسپ بله رسیدیم روی کاغذ که خلاص شده و
کاغذ بسته شده
بسته شده اما طبعاً تا که رئیس جمهور آمریکا ما هم به او موافقه نکنه نهایی نیست ما در اون مرحله قرار داریم
Taliban's endeavor and demands since the very beginning have been the ouster of these forces. They do not want Western powers to interfere in the matter of their interest. This is also the fundamental reason behind the Taliban hatred for the Ashraf Ghani government. There are about 14,000 US troops and around 17,000 troops from 39 NATO allies and partner countries in Afghanistan in a non-combative role. US will pull out one-third of its men in next few months.
اگر شرایط قسمی که در موافقه نامه صورت گرفت با مو قسم پیش بره در 135 روز 4-5 پایگاه که فعلی ما در او هستیم اونا را ترک میکنیم
In exchange for the phased withdrawal, the Taliban would commit not to allow Afghanistan to be used by militant groups such as Al-Qaeda or Islamic State as a base for attacks on the United States and its allies. However, things are not as easy as they seem to be. Taliban, which continue to target civil and military installations in the country, have not unveiled its own plans and intentions of going in the country. There are concerns among the civilians as well as fears that Afghanistan could be plunged into a new civil war, which would subsequently herald a return of Taliban rule and allow international militants, including Islamic State, to find a refuge.
د افغان پسواز موږ ټول هیله امدار چې خارجان بيدوزي په هغه صورت کې چې په افغانستان کې دایمي صلح او ثبات قائم شي
Experts who have been closely following the situation say that US should not have shown hurry and should have stayed more in the country, especially at a time when the security situation of the country is fragile and incapable of protecting the country.
وضعیت امنیتی افغانستان در یک بحران قرار داره آنچنانی که در تعهدات قبلی ایالات متحده آمریکا گفته بود عمل کرده نتانست سکتور امنیتی افغانستان به حد ضعیف است که نمیتونه حملات دشمن را دفع و طرد کنه بنان ما گفته میتونیم که یک دفعه اول امنیت افغانستان یک کور میشدن و بعد از اگر خروجشان میشدن کدام مشکل ما نداشتیم در این هم چه حالتی اگر میبره بدون ضرر افغانستان باقی نمیمونه
While Taliban have assured restoration of peace in the country on several occasions, it has not walked the talk on the ground. It has upped its offensive multifolds in past few weeks. While one would assume the ending of ghastly attacks in such circumstances, they are only counting the number of people losing their lives to the indiscriminate violence of these insurgents.
Moving on, It won't be an exaggeration if we call Pakistan a majoritarian state. Documents might suggest that it is a democracy, but in reality, it is the Islamic fundamentalists who call the shots in Pakistan. They have unleashed an anti-minority force of such intensity that today, Pakistan has become the most unsafe country for minorities across the globe. More and more number of cases are regularly hitting the headlines. There are incidents of discrimination, assault, and forced conversions. And this phenomenon is not confined to one particular area, but is widespread. Recently, a Sikh girl was abducted and converted before being married to an Islamic fundamentalist. A report.
In yet another cruel and heart-wrenching story from Pakistan, a Sikh girl was taken away from her parents, forcefully converted to Islam and taken custody of by Islamic fundamentalists through a bogus marriage in coach premises. Jagjeet Kaur, the daughter of a Sikh priest, is the latest victim of pervasive and still mushrooming religious extremism in Pakistan. The 18-year-old was converted at gunpoint. The family said they were threatened with life for putting up resistance.
जो कल लड़की आवाज़ की गई थी, वो मेरी सिस्टर है जगजीत कौर, उसको कल जबरदस्ती आवाज़ की थी, कि उसको धमकियाँ दी थी, अगर आप इस्लाम कबूल नहीं करोगे, तो आपके पापा और आपके भाई को दोनों को गोली मार दूँगा। कल उसको जबरदस्ती इस्लाम भी कबूल कर दिया। ते मेरा इमरान खान से ते चीफ अरबी कमर जावेद बाजवा से अपील है कि हमारी मदद करे।
This is not just about Sikhs, but the entire spectrum of Pakistani minority, whether it is Hindus, Christians, Sikhs, or even sects of Islam that do not fall in line with the fundamentalists are subjected to unimaginable pains. The radicals have multiplied in number in last couple of years, owing to a constant patronage provided to them by the civilian as well as military leadership of the country. Minorities might have equal rights for them on paper, but they cannot even turn their heads without permission. Their dissent and dissatisfaction is muzzled with highest degree of force. Religious minorities formed a significant part of the country before an unannounced ethnic cleansing drive was launched by Pakistan in the decades of 70s and 80s. Such is the situation today that people who contributed double-digit percentage are struggling for their existence. This is the reason they hold their anti-establishment demonstrations in more peaceful and more democratic states. Whether it is India or the United Kingdom, both have witnessed a string of anti-Pakistan protests in recent past. It is not just the religious minorities, but ethnic minorities like Balochs too have borne the brunt of this growing radicalism in Pakistan. Recently, they took to the streets of London against the Pakistani establishment. They gathered outside the house of British PM, seeking his intervention into rapidly deteriorating human rights situation in their region. They also submitted a written plea asking Britain to immediately halt all forms of aids and assistance to Pakistan, which was being used against them.
We are gathered here to protest against Pakistani atrocities that the Pakistani army and Pakistani intelligence agencies are committing in Balochistan and Sindh, Pashtunkhwa, Khyber Pakhtunkhwa. So the purpose of this protest is to show how Pakistani army and Pakistani intelligence are violating human rights in Balochistan and other places. Actually, Pakistan is perhaps the most dangerous military and intelligence agency in terms of abduction of Baloch political activists. So this is high time for the international community, especially for human rights groups, to step forward and to help Baloch people and help other ethnic groups who are suffering at the hand of Pakistani military and Pakistani intelligence agency, and to pressurize Pakistan to stop committing human rights violations.
Be it the Sindhis, Pashtuns, Shia community, political activities, or anyone who speaks against the suppressive policies of Pakistan, they become the targets of Pakistan's extremist groups and its army. According to the Commission of Inquiry on Enforced Disappearances, an entity established by the Pakistani government, around 5,000 cases of enforced disappearances have been registered since 2014, and most of them are still unresolved. But if we compare them with the figures of independent, local and international human rights organizations, the number is four times bigger. According to them, around 20,000 have reportedly been abducted only from Balochistan, out of which more than 2,500 have turned up dead with bullet-riddled bodies bearing signs of extreme torture. In the past few decades, things have only become worse for the minorities in Pakistan, the foremost reason being the radicalization of Pakistani society and government's apathy towards them. And if this alarming pace continues and the radicals are not tamed immediately, then the day is not far when Pakistan will become a graveyard for the minorities.
Moving on. The Bangladeshi government has partially blocked high-speed data services to areas where Rohingya refugees live. This has come in the line of improving law and order situation in the camps where the number of crimes is increasing. The tensions escalated in the wake of murder of a Bangladeshi national, which the authorities blame on Rohingya refugees. Only a few days back, the refugees had denied going back to Myanmar, citing various reasons. Many of them had also said that they were happy in the camps, where they said the life was way better than what they were living in their homes.
The Telecom Regulatory Authority of Bangladesh has asked mobile phone operators to partially block the high-speed data services in the sprawling camps of Cox's Bazar after a number of cases have been reported against Rohingya. Tensions are also running high in the camps after a youth wing leader from Bangladesh's ruling Awami League party was killed last week, allegedly by Rohingya refugees. Government says the decision, which has been dubbed and represented with various subtexts across various media houses, is solely aimed at improving the security situation. The operators have also been asked to stop selling mobile SIMs and block mobile services of Rohingya who have obtained this technology through fake means. While these services have been cut off for just few hours, the refugees say that they are facing a lot of problems in communicating with their relatives living in Saudi Arabia and Dubai. The government says that Rohingyas are extensively involved in drug trade, human trafficking, internal feud, killings and clash with the members of the law enforcement agencies. At least 80 Rohingyas were held in the last 5 months, for obtaining Bangladeshi passport with fake NID and birth certificates. A total of 471 criminal cases were filed against Rohingyas with local police stations in the last 2 years. Of them, 208 cases were related to Yaba or drug trade. At least 45 Rohingyas have been killed over the last 8 months as a result of internal feuds and gunfights with law enforcement personnel. Of these, 32 were killed during gunfights with the police and border guard Bangladesh. Rohingya, however, say that it is only a handful of people involved in wrongdoings and they are suffering because of their crimes.
12 lakh Rohingya se jere to ede hodun pura mura sondra ase ase to itara laboli hoy ara jodi mobile jodi bondh kore hol to ki le ara to solde hoyte ara to beshi hosto hobo beshi dukh paiyo beshi somoshya ase
somoshya gulo ki ki
somoshya mane ara ekana usir khobor loine bhai jo e Burma ta ase সৌদি আরব আছে, দুবাই আছে, মালয়েশিয়া আছে, বহুত জায়গাত আছে, তা আর এখানে অবসর খবর আর লই নহলে তা আর একা করিয়া নহলে সমস্যা হয়ে যায়।
Over 1.1 million in total Rohingyas are living in Cox's Bazar. Around 730,000 of them came only 2 years ago. The government of Bangladesh has made several attempts to initiate their repatriation. Twice the talks with the Myanmar government had reached the final stage. However, the repatriation failed on both occasions in a span of 1 year. The government has expressed its concern and incapacity at holding refugees anymore. Dhaka has also accused some 8 agencies of working against the interests of Bangladesh. It says that these agencies are telling refugees to say no to the repatriation. In response, it has also banned 2 agencies from working inside its territory.
Moving on, devotees in India's eastern state of Odisha thronged temples to celebrate a 3-day agrarian festival, Nuakhai. The harvest festival, which is also known as Nabanna, was celebrated with great fervor in the western part of the state as people of the region worshipped their presiding deities as a mark of gratitude for a bumper crop, good rain and a favorable weather for farming. Have a look.
With huge pomp and grandeur, people across western part of Odisha recently celebrated the 3-day harvest festival Nuakhai. They thronged the temples and offered the first grain of the harvest to the deity, which is different in different parts of the state, like goddess Samaleshwari in Sambalpur district. Celebrated to welcome the new crop and thank the deity for appropriate rain and favorable weather, the festival dates back to 12th century AD. Even today, the festival has maintained its significance and is celebrated with same enthusiasm across the region.
नुआखाई हम लोगों का गण पर्व है, कृषि भित्तिक पर्व है। ये साल में एक बार आता है, इसके हम लोग बहुत दिन से इंतजार करके रहते हैं, इसका प्रिपरेशन होता है। नुआखाई का 15 दिन पहले अपना घर बार सब सफाई करते हैं।
The preparations for the festival begin about a month in prior as people clean temples and prepare for the organization of the festival. People who stay outside to return to their native places and celebrate the new crop with the family members and relatives.
ये नुआखाई का दिन हम लोग घर में पहले से माने सब करते हैं और जितना भाई लोग भी बाहर में रहते हैं चाहे कोई अमेरिका में रहे या साउथ अफ्रीका में रहेंगे आज का दिन सब आते हैं एक ही साथ खाने के लिए नुआखाई जो खाते हैं
न्यू बीइंग द थीम ऑफ द फेस्टिवल पीपल यूज एवरीथिंग न्यू ऑन द ओकेजन इंक्लूडिंग न्यू क्लोथ्स बास्केट एंड लीव्स अर्लियर Nuakhai used to be observed on different days in various places, but since 1992, the festival has been observed on the same day throughout the state.
The occasion of Nuakhai is a renewal of mutual ties that spread warmth all around and binds the communities together in a spirit of solidarity in Odisha. Family members too forget their grievances and come together to celebrate the pious occasion. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.